Going to sixth. Flip of the coin. Steve calls tails. And let's see there. And as you can see, there you go. A gentleman's game. That's what pool should be, guys. A gentleman's game. Just as is golf. Same mindset, same principles, same sportsmanship. Take the ugly out. Don't need it. Leave the attitude at home. ...2015 BCAPL Championships, National Warm-Ups here in Tucson, Arizona at Casino del Sol. They've set up a room for us that you would not believe. It is awesome. They set up the Pro Arena here. They've got 32 tables on the side. Right now, about 20 of them are being used in singles matches. And so it's a great, great setup. You got Billy Palmer's billiard supplies. Steve's got the opening break. It's a race of seven. We'll see some good play now. Someone earlier on one of the matches, I think it was last night, I saw online where they said this is hard to watch. Well, it is. But this will be nice to watch. I believe he chose to use the side break and must have made a ball in the pocket because Trace is not stepping out, and I do see the ball at the bottom of the rack there, so he's got an open table. Table's not so open, but it's open for choice. Solids or stripes. Taking solids to the side pocket. The stripes are bundled up on the right. The solids are completely open. I'm actually looking for a run out here. He's probably looking at the 7, the deuce, the 5, the 6, and the 8. That's my pattern of choice. I don't think he can get to the deuce now, so he's going to have to shoot the 7 first. Lay the cue ball just to the right of where it is now. Shoot the 2. Position for the 5 in the side, the 6 in the corner, and the 8 in the side. Now, these guys will be doing some of the things I think will happen. With, you know, lower-rated players, so much of it is based on their ability. Well, he's gone too far over. So, you're going to have to shoot that ball in the corner. It does go. Yeah, he just readjusts his pattern is all he has to do. He's straight in the corner. He'll probably stop it, play the 1 in the side, come down for the deuce, the 5, and out again. So end result, a ball in the side pocket. He could decide to go ahead and play this, follow up just a hair, and then go 2 rails for shape on the 1, or the 5, excuse me. Go to the middle of the table for shape on the 5, then the 1 in the corner. Depending on his angle, I'm just going to stop it there, play the 1. Yep, that's what I thought. Now he can come down. If he chooses to bump the 5, he's okay. Because he may be not straight in, so he's got to get on the 2 ball next. The 5 doesn't go by the 2. So he's got to get on the 2 ball next. I don't foresee him trying to play position for the 5 here. He's playing for the 2 next. And then the 5 on the side. Tricky, though. I would say it's tricky because if he floats it just past the 11, he's toast. And he'll have to play a safety behind the 2 on the bottom of the table and trying not to leave Trace any shot whatsoever because the 11's makeable, the 10's makeable. And he's got a wall of balls to play safe behind. Key shot. Make the 1, shape on the 2. He does that, he's going to have to jack up. Jacking up reduces your aiming probabilities. Oh, looks like he doesn't have to jack up. Never mind. Huh. He queued underneath the 8. Not a problem. Now he can either hit the ball with inside ignition, come up between the 5 and the 11, and put the cue ball where that is. So he's going to go 2 rails to get there. These tables are awfully fast. To spin this ball and hold underneath the 12, it's going to take a good stroke, and the speed is delicate. Speed is key. I would rather go with the inside ignition, go between the balls. At worst, you bump the 5 or bump the 11, and you still have a shot. Now watch it spring. That was exactly the problem with playing that ball that way. Is it's going to spring. Now he's got a back cut. And this is, a 60-40 ball. Maybe higher. Makeable shot. He's going to hit the 11 ball and open him up. But I don't think he has anything else but to cut the ball. See anything else? There you go. Now, where did the cue ball end up? Bounce a little. He's got to cut to the side, to the corner, excuse me. But he was about 60-40 to make that ball. Maybe even 65-70-30. Now, here's a great example of the Fargo system. Steve Lillis is a master player, but he's a 36% favorite to win this game according to this Fargo system. Missed it. And we're about to see why. Trace comes to the table. That ball had to be made. Trace is a solid bar box player. On these diamond 7-footers, Trace is rather solid. He's been performing at a high level in Reno, in these championships, and all these tournaments he's played in, especially in the past 2 years. He's been doing better than ever in the past 2 years. He's got to get on these balls. He's got to put the cue ball on the right side of the table for this string of balls in the lower right and play them all to the left-hand corner. He's doing it this way, and he went. Did he overdo it? If he hits one, he's good. He didn't hit any. Now, see, he's got to hit this ball and still get to that side. Still get to that side. He could play safe. But playing safe here gives Steve the opportunity to kick in the 8 ball. It's close to a pocket. It's got a big rail in front of it on the left side. And it's got 2 rails on the bottom. He can 2 rail kick this ball if he stops him there. If he rolls him up on that 12, he's got to hit a rail. I don't think he got him. I don't think he got him. Anytime your acoustic is up in the air like that, your probability of executing the shot is lower than it would be if it wasn't up in the air. He used every bit of the pocket, and the 8 ball stood up and looked at him and said, okay, fine, I'll drop. Steve takes the first game. Let's see what the percentages change to. Now it's an even race to 6. Now, see, I can see why the percentages are off as they are, with one being ranked a master player and the other being ranked advanced. The Fargo ratings have Steve at a 641, and they have Trace at a 646. So this would make Trace a small favorite in an even race, as you can see now, because now it's an even race to six, and it is taking away the 7-6 race as far as the Fargo rating is an even race to six, and this is where they would come in on an even race. Trace being a little favored, even though he's rated an advanced player and Steve is rated a master. It's interesting how those little intricacies of a system like this, you know, you can have a player that's ranked higher in Fargo, but ranked lower in the division they play in. And I just think maybe things haven't caught up with Trace as far as being rated a master player. But and also another thing to consider is Steve's abilities may be declining due to age, possibly, as a lot of pool players do. You know, 5 years ago, maybe played two balls better. There's more variables involved. Nice position on this nine ball. He'll get position on the ball right next to it for the other opposite corner. Esther's looking where he has to go. And from there, he goes to the 10 in the side and then the eight ball. And, you know, 2-0. He's got to come up just a hair. He's probably okay to use rail first on this shot. I don't think the nine ball's on the rail, so he can go rail first. Soft speed. He wants to get straight in on this ball. Either straight in or a little below it, because he can use the three to stop it for the 10. Very well done. That's very pretty. Nice finesse touch. Did you see how he used inside English to come straight up? He used a little bit of left-hand English, hit that, and then when he hit the ball, it kind of, I don't want to say squirted, kind of rolled up and fell in the perfect position he wanted it to. And, of course, he pockets this, runs into the one ball, and an eight ball in the same pocket. Now you're seeing how eight ball is supposed to be played. You've been watching all day today and last night. You've been watching six-rated players, Jack and Jill teams, and missing easy shots, shooting questionable patterns, questionable shot selections. Now you're seeing real shot selections, real patterns, real shooting, real abilities. That was questionable. I didn't like the way he did that. Even if you can see it, I didn't like it. I would have run into the one ball. Now he's got a problem. By his body English, I'm thinking he's got a problem. I don't understand why he didn't go into the one ball. Now he's going to jump it, and he could have just stunned it right into the one ball. Instead, he drew over and got out of it. Didn't want to bump a ball. There's times you want to bump balls. A lot of players refuse to bump them. They think it's a mortal sin. Well, I'm here to tell you, in that particular instance, bumping the ball would have won you the game for sure. You wouldn't have made that jump shot. But now you see some, like I said, you can see some abilities. Some of these things that work against lower-rated players will not work in this venue. Not at this caliber. He didn't have to jump too high because he was only going maybe over a quarter ball, if that. So, but anytime you're elevating, room for error. Game number two goes to Steve Lillis. Now he's a 60% favorite to win this, making Trace 40%. Trace needs six games. Steve needs five. 2-0 and a race to seven. He goes to seven. Trace goes to six. Let's hope Trace doesn't get too comfortable in that. Well, dry break, rare at this level, but not rare for a 7-foot table. That happens a lot. You want to break from the middle? Well, there's different breaks. Different people use different breaks. It works different speed. English, well, I don't think English makes a difference, except to control the cue ball. But breaking the rack, speed is everything. And stroke. Nice firm hit gets you a lot more than you think it does. But Trace is the table with a straight in shot down for the 14, followed by the 10 or the 12 on the side. 10 is his problem ball, so he wants to get rid of it now. He wants to come straight back, and then he'd like to be, ideally, he'd like to be right where he is now. If he is, he can open up that 8, 5, that little cluster of balls by the 8 ball on the rail. He can open them all up and be guaranteed a shot on the 11. Yeah, you want to go into this ball with a little bit of speed, not too soft. I think that ball still goes on the side, so he's good. But he's got to do something about the 13. I believe he can do it now. I believe he can play this ball in the side pocket. If it goes by the 5, nope, it doesn't go by the 5. He has to go to the corner. Because if it goes by the 5, he'd have shot it already. If it goes by the 5, he's able to go to the rail, move the 13, have the 14 in the side, opposite side pocket, and get right out. Instead, he's having to go into the 13 off the 14. That ball by the 5 won't go, will it, Steve? Taking a second look at it, and it won't. He's playing this in the corner pocket, attempting to move it. Very, very well done. Well, I'm going to have to say that that ball goes, and he chose to keep that for his key ball. He'll come back to the exact position where he's at now. A little bit more and close this out. Well, he chose to leave it there, so it must go. And go it did, and Trace is on the board. Let's see how your odds change. See if they go back to where Trace is a favorite again. Two to one. Trace is going to run for a second. He'll be back momentarily. Meanwhile, we'll run a couple of commercials for you. Or either that, or I'm going to start singing and dancing, and Steve's going to go crazy. Steve Kwan is the guy that's taking care of all the camera work and all the computer work. I'm just sitting here flapping my jaws. Okay, Trace is back. And we're back in action. Trace is trailing 1-2, but he still has a 52% chance of winning this match, according to the Fargo ratings. According to me, this is anybody's match. The gentleman that makes the mistakes will lose the match. Mistakes will kill you in this game. And actually, I believe Trace has already made one. And he's down, but he's only down a game. So. Broken wide open. Everything is spread out. Nothing is bundled up. Everything has a pocket. I look for Trace to run out here. There's 4 stripes left on the table. He made 3 stripes. If he can see the 12 ball, he'll shoot that first. 12 ball is in the bottom right-hand corner. Followed by the 9, the 13, the 14. He's going to take solids. Now, they're all open too, but I'm having to say, I guess he couldn't see the 12 ball. Good thing is, he's got to make 7 balls. Bad thing, he's got to make 7 balls. The good thing is, they're all open, they're all available, they all have pockets available. He'll have to make a mistake not to get out. What surprised me was, if he could have seen that 12 ball, which I guess I'm going to have to say he couldn't see it, he should have taken the stripes, could have taken the stripes, and only had to run 4 balls, which were also all open. He pocketed the 9, then the 13, ball on the side, and you were out. You get by that 12, get on that 9, ball up on top, and you were done. But this has a nice flow to it, too, so this is a little delicate here. He cannot afford to leave himself the combination on the 1-5. And he's afraid of coming over, so he's going to take the harder shot, which is the 5. Instead of the deuce. Don't get too straight. Now he's perfect. The 8 ball goes in the lower right hand corner pocket, so all he has to do is kind of stun the ball to the center of the table. Kind of just like that. Over for the 1. Pretty much same shot coming out away from the rail, although he's a little too straight. Little too straight, but the stun's just. Maybe not so. You could draw it, but on this little table, on the 7-foot table, this draw can be dangerous. You're afraid to go too much, so you have a tendency of not hitting enough. Not hitting enough leads you right to the side pocket. Yeah, that's what I thought he would. I thought he would just stun it and force it off the rail, which he did. Trace does that rather well. I played Trace on numerous occasions, and he does that rather well. Nice angle coming in. Looks like he doesn't have a full pocket. He's not real happy with this. He does not have a full pocket. That's going to be costly. Costly, costly, costly. Now, seeing what he did there, that draw on that ball in the corner, instead of the stun, would have been key because he would have been playing that A ball to the opposite corner pocket. So, it did look like that A ball had plenty of room, but then we put the camera on it. Up jumped the devil. The 12 ball must have moved, but there was not enough room. Uh-oh, it's a side pocket there. There's just, ooh, my. He rolled that ball and took his chances, huh? Says, I pay my money, I take my chances. See Mike Massey in the background there, right behind Steve. They're traveling buddies. On the way to the Philippines to execute a ministry. Oh boy. He's in a little bit of trouble. He can cut the ball, but he's gonna hit this nine ball and possibly double kiss it. He's not sure where the cue ball is going to go, and he's not sure where the nine ball is going to go. It looks like they'll both go towards the right side of the table together, and I think he's going to end up straight into the corner pocket on the right side if he hits this with just center English. Maybe even a little right center English. That's how I would be shooting it. I think it just comes right over. The double kissing goes right over. He did it real soft. There you go. And he's going to like this 3-1 lead. Traces mistake. Wrong pocket for the eight ball. Game number four goes to Steve Lillis, and he'll take a 3-1 lead over Trace Kane, making him a 62% favorite to win this match, according to Fargo ratings. We're in Tucson, Arizona, Casino del Sol. 2015 warm-ups for the 39th annual National Championships in Las Vegas, Nevada, being held at the Reno, July 22nd through August 1st. In conjunction to the National Championships, you have the U.S. Open Men's, U.S. Open 8-Ball, U.S. Open 10-Ball. All the pros will be there. Steve breaking the balls. Side break again. I personally don't like the side break. A lot of players like it. The reason I don't like the side break, it seems to create clusters. It doesn't break open. Cue ball is harder to control. Trace has taken the stripes. They're all open. The 8-ball goes to the side pocket right where the 13 is. Now it's just a matter of maneuvering. 13 in the side, 9-ball in the corner. Work your way from that cluster of balls over towards the middle of the table. Play the combo on the 14, the 15 in the opposite corner, the 12 in the corner. 8-ball on the side, or a variation thereof. It all starts there. Forget the combo. He's going to go to the 14 and get on either the 12 or the 15. Well done by Trace. Bounce a little bit. Slight stun shot. Careful not to disturb the 8 or the 6. Careful not to disturb those balls. Ouch, ouch, ouch. He's got a rail first shot, I believe. I think he can give this just a little bit of rail first to make this ball. Yes, there you go. 8 ball on the side. Thin cut. Delicate. Delicate, delicate, delicate. Ooh. Plus the 6 ball. No, we're fine. Perfect. Trace is back in it. Trailing by 1 game. 2-3. Probably back to a 50% favorite. So is that a favorite? Let's find out what it goes to. Let's see what happens when we enter that 1 game. Breaking the balls. 2-3. Trailing 2-3, he's breaking the balls. Trace will smack him from the side. Cut break. I believe he'll hit the center ball, trying to hold the cue ball in the center of the table. No, he used the side break also. He used the side break also. Hit the second ball, came over to the side rail, back to the middle of the table. He's a 52% favorite to win this match now. He's down by a game. So this Fargo system is rather interesting. Intricate. And delicate. And from the sounds of everything I heard about it, it sounds as solid as a system as could be. Once your players have somewhere in the vicinity of 250 to 300 games in, it's pretty established. I think your handicap will be pretty established. I just wonder how many games Trace has in. What?
Say your name.
Okay. For those of you out there, you don't know who George Teyechea is. That's me. I'm from Tucson, Arizona. I do the commentary. I've been doing the commentary for the Desert Classic Tour since about 2008. Just converted to the Diamond Pool Tour. I do a little bit of that. I help Lenny out with the commentary. He does a live stream, and I help him with the commentary. And then Ozzy Reynolds decided he wanted a commentator, wanted to live stream this event, asked if I'd help out, and here I am. In your face. Just kidding. Trying to keep you abreast of what might be going on. Any suggestions will be greatly appreciated. You're the listeners. I'm just sitting here giving you my version of what I see with a few announcements here and there and some information that was just disclosed regarding the Fargo rating system. Unfortunately, I don't look at the chat. I don't have it in front of me. It's on a different computer. All I have in front of me is what you see on your screen and the pool table itself. I'm sitting about 20 feet, maybe even a little further, about 21, 22 feet from the left edge of the corner pocket to the bottom of the table as you see it on your screen. In fact, I'm about maybe 3 feet to the left of the corner pocket. I have a monitor that shows me exactly what you see. and my imagination. Monitor works well, my imagination, not so much. Steve's in a little bit of a dilemma here, where to go, what to do. Looks like he can see the two ball. But, he wants to know where to go after that. Well, after that, if he solids, he can see the six too, I think. If he solids, he can draw straight back for the three in the corner, upper right hand corner. Oh, he's going to play the three now. Never mind. He must not be able to see the two ball as clear as he wants it to. Or he's afraid of drawing back into the 12. Yes, he is. If he draws it back, he's going into the 12. He draws it back with speed. He might end up in the side pocket off the 12. Trace got back to the table. I kind of missed what happened with the three ball. He must have made it and scratched. Okay. Decisions for Trace. I don't think I'd shoot this ball. He does that so well. That's why I wouldn't shoot, because I can't execute that shot as well as he can. He does that so well. Now he comes up for the ball on the side, or he can draw it for that 12 in the corner, go into the middle of the table for the 11 in the corner or the side, and then the other ball. Or 11 in the corner. The other ball in the other corner, and stays away from that. There you go. Never mind, he went for the 11 inside. And now you just stop it there and shoot the 12, then the 14 to the lower right-hand corner pocket and get on the 8. Variation thereof. Either shot here works. Either shot works. It leads him to the 8. If he shoots the 14, he slides to the left, giving him an angle to go to the right for the 8. If he shoots this, he goes this way. There you go. And he can just follow this for the 8 in the side or the corner. No, he's perfect. He'll play this to the side. Probably run into this ball. No, he doesn't. Whoa. And we'll be all tied up at threes in about three more strokes. One more stroke. Two more strokes. Tied up at three. Three apiece. Now you see how this Fargo ranking system works out. Yeah, one player at 642, I think it was, and the other player at 646. Yet the lower rated player is a master player, the higher rated player is an advanced player. He's getting a game on the wire, which makes him a big favorite in a race to six, since he's got the higher rating on the Fargo. As soon as this ties up, you'll see a big increase for Trace now, since he's getting a one game handicap again. He's getting a one game handicap and score's tied. So it's a race to four with a one-game handicap. He's going to be about a 15% favorite. Ooh. Huge favorite now. Two-thirds favorite. jumped up real quick with just a one game lead. They're both using the side break, and actually, that's why I don't like the side break. Don't have to make a ball. Leave clusters. If he likes solids, he's got three of them to go to the side pocket. One that goes in the corner. Solids are all open. Everything's open here. He's just going to pick those balls right at the side pocket, one after the other. This reminds me of playing snooker with a wild six ball, and you get it on the spot, and you just line up that six ball and make it 35 or 40 times in a row. Years and years and years and years ago, I used to do that. And the snooker table we used to play on was a Gandhi, and it had huge pockets for a snooker table. Just wants to get on the... Make sure that two ball goes, yes. Make sure that goes. And get on the five ball, then get on that deuce, or the three. Get up, get up, get up, get up, get up. He didn't get up. Now he's forced to go into the nine ball with a cue ball. Or come close to that eight and get on to three. But I don't think he wants to play shape on that. He's forced to go into the nine. There you go. But what that does is it closes a window for him. It narrows a window for him, excuse me. That nine ball can now hinder the one, but he's going to play shape on the three. Small window, so he's got to stop it dead. The cue ball shouldn't move after it hits the three. Perfect. And now we play the three ball, then the one ball, and you come down for the eight. Let's see where he ends up with this ball. He's got to make sure he misses that 13 ball. He's got to make sure he misses that 13 ball. He wants to come in underneath it, over by the corner pocket, and come down past the nine. And at that, he's going to have to get fortunate. He did not get fortunate. Tricky, tricky, tricky. See, when you're running the cue ball, what happens? You got to let the balls lead you to your next shot. If you start running the cue ball around on a busy table, on a 7-foot busy table, with a lot of balls in it, that will be a foul as he hit the rail before he hit the eight. No rail after contact. Steve has an open table. One ball is blocking the eight. The nine ball leads him to position on that ball. He'll probably shoot the 12 ball last. The last two balls I'm shooting will be the nine and the 12. I'm shooting these two balls on the bottom, opening them up right now if I have a shot. And then taking the three balls on the side, shooting the nine ball with position for the 12, and the nine ball on the side or corner, position on the 12 for the left-hand corner pocket, and saying goodnight to this rack. Never mind, he's going to shoot that first. This is dangerous. He's going to be shooting a combination, I believe, because I don't think it goes by the 11. He's going to shoot a combination with ball in hand. Interesting. Now remember, he's a master player. I'm an open player, so I'm not sure. Never mind. He could see the ball. I thought from the angle I was looking at, he couldn't get by that ball. So whatever I said was irrelevant. Moot point. I still kind of like leaving that 12 ball there and having it the last ball I shoot, especially having the 9 ball that leads me for position to it. I kind of like having it there. I can make an error and know I'm going to leave my opponent an extremely difficult shot. But then again, level of play, confidence of running balls, not a problem here. They both have plenty of confidence to be able to run balls that are open like this. But they're not completely open. This, he's looking at that 14. I'm not so sure that's completely open. We'll see how it plays out. Let's take a look at how it plays out. Just because he's not running the patterns that I think he could have run doesn't mean he's wrong. It doesn't mean I'm wrong. It just means that he's got some work to do. Doesn't lay easy. We're going to find out if it goes right here. He's going to play it in play position on the 10. Doesn't seem happy about it. That's tight. I think it goes. Let me just draw this back. He might just stop it there in case he misses the 9 ball, blocks it. He's uncomfortable. He doesn't like it. He's looking at what kind of a landing area he needs to take advantage of this shot. It's not very big. He's only got a couple of inches to play with. Up jumped the devil. Up jumped the devil. The difference in the patterns he chose and the difference in the pattern I chose is that he shot the ball that I would have shot last. He shot it first, I would have shot it last. As we're looking at this now, it's irrelevant because most of us won't remember exactly what he had. He's going to try to push it. Nope, didn't do it. Well, Trace comes to the table with a little bit of a long shot for a 7-foot table. But I'd say he's a 97% since reason percentage, he's a 97% chance of making this ball, maybe even 99. I think if he shot it 100 times in this same situation, he would make it 99 times out of 100. But he'd probably fall asleep somewhere around 48. Takes a one game lead. He needs 2 games, his opponent needs 4. So it's a 1 game lead in games, but a 2 game lead in the race. How is that a 2 game lead? Let's see. He needs 2 games, his opponent needs 4. Trace is now a 82% favorite to win this match, according to Fargo ratings. But you and I know that in a race to 7, even with the game on the wire, an 8-ball, it can be overcome. It can be overcome. But the alternate break format, limits your ability to overcome it. Side break again. These balls opened up pretty good. Nothing drops. Open table. If you're going to overcome it, got a break serve here. Steve is down here from New Jersey en route. They were just in California for a fundraiser. Him and Mike Massey are traveling together. They're on their way to the Philippines. And they're going to do some work in the Philippines with exhibitions, presentations, speaking engagements, seminars. Steve is traveling with Mike Massey en route to the Philippines, and they were just in California doing exhibitions, fundraisers to get to the Philippines. And here he is running balls. Bank. Get by it. Oh, not quite enough, but he goes to the other corner pocket, so he's good. His options here. He's trying to get a good pattern. I kind of like playing. Well, that A ball's in a tough place. It only goes to the right-hand corner pocket. If you don't move balls, you don't have to move it. I'm going to play the 12 ball first. The 10 ball, the 11 ball. Sorry. The 12 ball, the 14 ball in the rail, then the 10 ball. Oh, I'm coming over for that other ball first. And then get an angle on the 10, get on the 11 straight, and get on the ball by that 4. He's looking at it in the side. I like it in the corner. And actually, you can shoot it in the corner and open up the ball there. It opens up that hole for the 8 ball, too. You have to hit it with some pace, but it'll open it up. He's going to shoot the ball now. Huh? Going to shoot it in the side, I think. That's what he's looking. He's looking to shoot it in the side. It works because you can still get to that corner pocket on the left with the cue ball for position on the 8. The 9 ball leads him there, as does the 14 on the rail on the right-hand side. Harder shot, but it will lead him there. Low percentage lead. 9 ball's the best way to get there. I actually kind of like getting straight on the 11 and then on the 14 and following it down. But you have to be so precise, so precise. We're in Tucson, Arizona. Best venue that's been set up here that I've ever seen in my 45-year career of playing pool, if you want to call it a career. My time playing pool, how's that? Do you follow these two rails for shape on the 14, or do you draw the ball? Because you want shape on the, you want straight in shape on the 14, and then you want an angle, you want to have the angle to lead you to the 8. That's what he's looking at now. He's oh my. Move the 8 ball with his cue stick. Opponent has a It's one way to get a better landing space for the eight ball. Is to move it. Don't scratch him. Ooh, my. So he was a little fortunate not to scratch. Unfortunate to catch the corner. He hits above the corner. He's perfect on this ball. Hits below. Hits where he did. Saved him from scratching. So there was good and bad in that shot. And now he's kind of forced to shoot the nine. Or come with a great shot on this 14. And no matter what he shoots, he won't be able to hold for an angle on that nine ball for the eight. That's the one problem when you're in a real tight pattern. A little bit, half an inch makes a difference where you hit the cue ball. Steve's in a little bit of trouble here. He's a little bit of a bind. He's got to find a way to pocket this nine ball, get position on the 14 with an angle to get to the upper left-hand corner pocket. He gets straight in on the eight. This is a draw shot, I think. Draw this ball inside between the two and the one and lay it on this 14. But if you don't get the angle for it, you're not going to be able to get down there. I don't see an option. I'm an open player. He's a master player. Maybe he'll show me an option I didn't see. Move the ball and take a shot. There you go. He says, I'll bump the eight ball out just right. Give myself a shot on the 14 and put the eight ball in position to make it. Difference in play, right there. Oh, that's such a common thing. After a great shot comes a mistake. You think you beat the monster, and all of a sudden, you let him live. Trace is taking a short break, and he'll be back facing seven balls on the table. All open, a good pattern, takes care of everything. I'm starting with the... Well, Trace is back in the arena. I'm going to grab the cue and put it to work. Started out with a combo, and now the one ball's next, or the four ball. He's got several options. When he gets to the top there, he wants to pocket the one, stop it, pocket the five, the two, and then the six, and then the eight. Plenty of options here. Just wants to make sure if he shoots this one ball, that he comes down for the five. There you go, just stop it. From where I was looking at it, it looked like he had an angle that he couldn't just stop it dead. That was going to have to run to the head rail and back. Center English splits the balls, shoots two ball shoots over to the corner pocket. Just like that, and there he is. Gonna have to play it in the corner. A little bit of an angle to the corner. The degree of difficulty went up just a little by coming down to that angle, but not much. Trey should make this. It does. Gets perfect on the eight. And we'll now take a 5-3 lead. Trace needs one, his opponent needs four. What does the Fargo rating system tell us? It's going to tell us he's about a 95% favorite. I think. Let's take a look. Now, when I say these things, I'm guessing because I've never seen the Fargo system till it was explained to me last night. And I've seen some of it today now with the singles matches. One of the advantages I have when it comes to percentages is I worked with them all my life. So when it comes to numbers, I can crunch them. Side break. Makes it in the corner. Whoa. The corner ball went straight in the corner. Interesting. And let's see. The stripes are not wide open. He's only got one ball tied up. And he can break it right now if he wants it to. He doesn't really have any other shot, I don't think, except the one ball or the four ball. Oh, this could lead. He's perfect. He's down far enough past the side pocket. He can play this five ball easily. Now will he play position for the four ball by itself or play position for the combo? Neither one. He played position for the two ball on the side. Well, that's what he ended up with. I don't think he played position for that, but that's what he ended up with. Things can get tricky here. He's got an angle that he doesn't really want. It sends the cue ball up table, and he'll be faced with a combo either way. Unless his speed is perfect and he can go up and down and lay the cue ball right where the deuce is now. If he can do that, he shouldn't be trailing 3-5. Because that's exceptional mastery of the speed of the table. He's traveling the ball 7 feet, close to 7 feet. He's playing the combo. All or nothing right here. He's betting the match on this combo. And from what I see, what he's got here, I think I'd have to do the same thing. Got to make it and actually open up that ball. And it's next to the ball. Nice shot. And he opened it up. But look what happens to this three ball. Oh, my. Here's where you look up and you pull your hair and say, the Saints are against me. Made a nice shot. A little bit more pace. He may have been okay because it would have slid by. But that three ball still would have tied up. But you really couldn't foresee that. I didn't foresee that. For his sake, I hope he throws to the seven ball, because if it is, he could throw it in. But he still has to. He still has to be concerned with this ball. Look at this shot. Look at this shot, folks. He just cut the ball down the rail, got perfect on the six to possibly break out the seven ball. Well, not perfect, because he's kind of shaking his head like just a little bit more would have been perfect. Another inch on that ball if it had a seven ball roll towards the pocket or the cue ball down a little bit. I think he can break it out with high left. What do you think? No? Too much of a cut? Yeah. Can't really tell from here if that ball comes straight down. It looks like it's going to hit right about where the diamond is. And if he's got a lot of left, it's going to throw a little further out, so it's going to be hard to hit it. What do you think about banking the six ball two rails into that 10 ball and laying the cue ball on the bottom rail? Looks like he's got an angle to do that. So he removes the 10 from the side pocket and the cue ball's frozen on the bottom rail. Never mind, I'll just come with that shot. How strong was that? No, I didn't get what he wanted, but how strong was that? The possibility was there. But that's one of those shots where you sit back and you hit it great and you say, I almost got there. I did all that and ended up with just this. Off the 10. Good call. And he's got shape on the 8. Shoots that. Ozzie says, just bank the ball into the 10 of the side pocket and go two rails for shape on the 8. Watching his mind work here, he hasn't even looked at the possibility of banking the ball on the side. Now he's looking. He's going to attempt to kick this ball in the side pocket, in the corner pocket, excuse me. Attempt? What a shot. Again, look what he ended up with. Oh, my God. How many gotch shots is he going to have to come with here? This is a kick. If he made that kick shot, this one should be no problem. Wow. Come on. I want to see some comments in the chat room. What do you think of those shots? Were those jelly rolls or were those shots? Wow. We were just privy to a couple of great shots. How'd you make that play back? No. Ozzy Reynolds says he couldn't buy a roll in a bakery. All you can do is just kick this ball in. You got to kick it pure, pure. He missed that by a half inch. I mean, where the A ball ended up was a half inch. He missed the kick by a quarter. He traveled the ball 4 feet and missed it by a quarter of an inch on his angle. My, my, my. Trace doesn't have much of a shot here. He's got to go for it. He was looking to see if he could play him safe behind the 14, but I wouldn't risk that. I'd have to go for the run out here. Get down there, get down there, get down there. He didn't get down there. He'll have to take that later. He'll have to get, probably save that for his last ball. Shoot the ball on the side. Ball up by the 8. Ball in the middle of the table, then the 15, and the ball in the bottom rail. Just like this. He might switch gears and shoot the ball, the 14, or the whatever ball that is, the 12, or the 14, or the 15, the 9. And then 13's next. 13's next. Got to make it. Can't leave it out. Dead center. Take that. Two great shots by Steve Lillis, and he still can't. Whoa. He'll follow this two rails. Never mind. Just draw back. I think I ought to follow that two rails. Probably got in the same place, but match is over. Great match. Both players got some good shots there at the end. Steve made some fantastic shots. Yeah, in fact, Trace just said, this was a great shot when you came to have all that two rails. And